I was born in the 1950s, and I was raised in Nebraska, but I was born in a really little town in Iowa, and we were the only Jewish family in that town. And my mother decided it was really important for people to understand that while we were different, they needed to understand who we were a little bit better than they did. And so my mother started going around to church groups in the area and explaining a little bit about what it meant to be Jewish and exposing people to something that was different in small town America. And I saw my mother do that, and I thought it was, at first, I thought it was kind of cool, but I also saw that it was really courageous. And she taught me something in her doing that. And the interesting thing is, when we moved to Nebraska, which had a little bit bigger community, a bigger Jewish community, but also a more diverse community in Lincoln, Nebraska, she then joined with other women who were Latino, Mexicans, and blacks, and Catholic, and Protestant, and they formed something called the Panel of American Women. And they would go around then and each tell their story and each talk about diversity. And I'm talking about in the 1960s, early 1960s. This was Lincoln, Nebraska. This isn't something that was being done anywhere else. And I don't even know how they came up with it. But it taught me something at a really young age that I think it's really important for us to push ourselves to understand people who are different. So in 2012, I was in Nashua, New Hampshire, when we found out that Mitt Romney was going to be holding, he was going to be the guest speaker at a Chamber of Commerce breakfast in our hotel. And of course, we felt that we had to participate in that in some way, and that we really had to get him to address the issues. And so we organized a few of us to get tickets and to go into this breakfast meeting. And we divided up into pairs and sat around the room. And we all had a question that we were going to ask if we got a chance. And of course, we were immediately identified by the sales personnel for the hotel and pointed out as UAW troublemakers. And so they were never going to ask us any questions. And it came close to the end, and he said one more question, and I was raising my hand, and everybody else from the UAW was raising her hand, and they bypassed us, and I knew that was the last question. So without a microphone, I just stood up.
How can you say that those people from your own state of Michigan would have been better off under bankruptcy, where they would have really, very likely lost their jobs instead of where they are today, because once again, the number one auto company in the United States. I don't understand.
This is what we need to do. We need to confront power, and when we hear something that we know is wrong, we need to challenge it. And I think right now in particular, I think we're living at a time when the messaging for the last year has been, it's okay to say disrespectful things about women. It's okay to attack women. We need to stand up to that and say it is not okay. You need to be respectful of us. And I think we have a particular message to carry to show our children that we're not going to go backwards. We're not going to allow this country to go backwards, and we're not going to allow ourselves to go backwards. And so the Women's March to me was very inspiring. There have been so many ways that our union has made a difference in women's lives, particularly. I talked a little bit about organizing at Columbia University, the clerical workers there, and at that time, their wages were far lower than their male counterparts in, say, house cleaning. And the major difference was they had not been organized, and the house cleaners had been organized, the housekeeping had been organized since 1941. And so over time, they had developed really high wages and good wages. And so in organizing clerical workers in particular at that time, we were able to make substantial gains in minimum hiring rates and really begin to deal with the inequality of women earning less than men. And clearly within the childcare world, we've made a huge difference in raising standards as well. When you get into areas like health and safety, back in the 1970s, people were totally unaware of some of the health and safety problems that women were faced, or secretaries were faced with, by working on computers. At that time, we called them VDT monitors, and there were tremendous problems with ergonomic issues around the way your hands rested on the keyboard, problems with the microwaves that are emitted from the screens in those days. And so we really focused on those issues and tried to draw attention to it and tried to raise awareness around these issues, and did get health and safety committees that would study the ergonomic issues, that would study the issues of microwaves. And so, you know, we saw real progress being made. And I think that there is a greater awareness today in our union about these women's issues and how they're not just women's issues, because they affect our families, because they affect all of us. Now is the moment to shed all fear, to get involved, and to stand up. And if you have small children, bring them with you. I have always taken my children to everything I engaged in, and I found everyone around me supportive of that. Don't be afraid, bring your children with you. You can do anything. And we need to make sure that that legacy that was, you know, that Women's History Month really celebrates the legacy of all the women who came before us and all the struggle they went through. We can't allow that. We can't go backwards. We can't allow anything that's happening today to hold us back. And there are so many opportunities, you know, within our communities, within our organizations. We need to step forward and take responsibility and stand up for what's right and for what we value. And in the end, it will be very important to our children and to the next generation.